Good evening, everybody, and thank you for attending tonight's program with Elaine Morse, part of Blaine County Museum's Fall 2024 Speaker Series, hosted by our wonderful partners, Ginger Hansen and the Chinook Senior Center. It's good to be back in this welcoming environment, enjoying local history with all of you here tonight. As Ginger said, I'm Samantha French. I'm the director of Blaine County Museum. I had to write that note down to remember to say that, and Ginger was making fun of me. Introduced a couple times now. Okay.
Come out with it. So.
Since the museum began organizing speaker programs in 2023, we have been collecting attendee feedback to gather insights about what topics to represent in the future. The topic of homesteading has been one of the most requested, and when I sought out a local authority on the subject, Elaine was suggested to meet by multiple individuals. I'm thrilled she's with us here tonight to shed light on this subject, which defines the origins of so many of our Montana communities. Elaine's sister, Arlene Rice, is also here tonight to help answer questions you might have following this program during the Q&A. And Arlene, if you're out there, can you raise your hand so everyone, there's Arlene. Thank you for being here, Arlene. Elaine has also brought copies of the book In the Even More Years Gone By, just to my right here, about the Hill County homesteading communities of Cottonwood and Simpson she'll be speaking about tonight. These will be available for purchase, and Elaine, who is one of the book's authors, will be signing copies. Books are $60, and proceeds will go towards the Clack Museum Foundation. So please stay a while to snack, converse, and do some shopping. Before we begin, I'd like to cover a few housekeeping items. At each seat, you will find those aforementioned program surveys that the museum uses to gather attendee feedback. Please complete one at the end of tonight's presentation. Remember, we do actually review them and use the feedback you provide to inform future museum programs and events. This is an opportunity for your voice to be heard. All Museum Speaker Series programs are free to attend, but if you enjoy this program, please drop a donation in our contribution box, making its rounds through the room. Donations make it possible for us to continue to host speakers, paying their mileage, lodging, and honoraria. We also brought our card reader tonight, and you can donate with a card if you so choose. You can also purchase books later on our card reader. If you have not been to the Senior Center before, restrooms are behind you to the left. Please take a moment now to silence or turn off your phone as a courtesy to your speaker and your fellow attendees. And now I'll introduce Elaine. Elaine Morse was born in Havre, Montana, and raised on a farm at Simpson, Montana, 38 miles north of Havre. Both sides of her family were founded by homesteaders in the Simpson area during the homesteader rush. She attended 8 years in a rural country school, then attended Havre High School, Northern Montana College, and the University of Montana, where she earned her BS in pharmacy. Elaine served as the director of pharmacy at Northern Montana Hospital, retiring in 2020 after 34 years. She became involved in the H. Earl Clack Museum in Havre shortly after returning to the community, and then transitioned to the Clack Museum Foundation Board. She has served as the chairman of this board for many years. Please help me welcome to the podium, Elaine Morse.
Hi, everybody. I'm Elaine Morse. I am not a historian. I know that's what they preferred to have, but I'm just a history nerd. And so I'm a specialist in knowing about our local area. And so let me do my Vanna White thing. This is our wonderful book, and I'll talk more about that as we get going. But first, let's talk a little bit about the Homestead Act. I think everybody, is there anybody here who's a real homesteader or a descendant of a homesteader? Everybody. Okay, the original Homestead Act that we didn't care about was in 1862, and it was called the Free Homestead Act. And any U.S. citizen could file on a quarter section, which is 160 acres. And you only had to be the head of the household, at least 21 years of age, and you had to be a citizen who was legally here, and you could not have been fighting against the U.S. or its allies. Pretty stiff. Okay, the thing is, this was designed by our U.S. government to open up the lands that had been acquired for immigrants, farmers who did not have their own land, single women, and formerly enslaved people. Because this was, again, 1862, and the Emancipation Proclamation had been done shortly before that, in 1863. So part of getting that quarter section of land is the people had to prove up the land. And the way to prove up a land is you had to live on that land for 5 years. You had to build a home. I think that's kind of loose. I think it was more a shack, probably. You had to cultivate the land, and you had to improve it over those 5 years. Okay, well, when they first put the Homestead Act in, 160 acres was just divine if you lived in the fertile Midwest. 160 acres was pretty good. You could make a living. Well, in Montana, 160 acres is not enough for one cow, I presume. So they decided that maybe they needed to tweak that law. And so in 1877, they came up with the Desert Land Act. Do you guys all know we live in the desert? According to the definition, we don't get enough rain. We're considered desert. And that act increased the amount of the land grant to 640 acres, a full section. Sounds good, doesn't it? Except, in order to get that 640 acres, you had to have it irrigated within 3 years. Well, guess what? That's a little hard to come by in some areas that we're living in. So what happened is during that period of time, you had some of the big ranchers with cattle and sheep that would get their whole crew to claim a section, and then they had a big ranch. Well, they decided maybe that wasn't going quite as well as they had hoped because they weren't getting many claims. So in 1909, they came up with the Enlarged Homestead Act. And that was the act that we all know about because it actually made farming or land grants in Montana feasible. Because it increased the acreage from the quarter section, 160 acres, to 320 acres, which was a half section, which, not huge, but it was enough that you could survive. And then 3 years after they had put in this enlarged, where you could get 320 acres, they also changed it so that your prove-up time went from 5 years to 3 years, which also helped. So, but then they required that at least 1/8 of the land was cultivated for agriculture crops continually. So I'm not sure what the difference between continually is and strip farming, but there you go. The other thing that I think is really interesting with our homestead story is, are you guys aware of the impact of the railroad? Okay. Part of the reason that we have homesteads in this area, and part of the reason that Hill County is named Hill County, is because of James J. Hill. And again, government decided that it was really important to us to have transcontinental railroads. And so they made deals that allowed the railroad, in order to make tracks across the country, they allowed the railroad to basically buy up land at a very reasonable price, public lands. Well, guess what? Public lands in this country tended to be the Indian reservations. And one of the articles that I read about this was basically any land is public land, and it's only Indian land if it's got a teepee on it. And if it had a teepee on it, they couldn't build the railroad there. Now, I don't know if that's a little bit of a stretch, but then they also, when the railroad was going through, they were paying them by the mile. And so, well, guess what? That's why we don't have, because that's what they have in the southern part of the state, is because they paid them by the mile, and so nothing was straight. Well, James J. Hill decided that the only way that he could build his railroad to the Pacific Northwest, which is where he wanted to get to, was to make this area between Chicago and Seattle into an agricultural stronghold. And so it was very important to him that he improve the population, make it so that there were businesses and farmers and ranchers in the area, because that's what he was going to do, is use his railroad to haul people and freight and animals and whatever. The part where they could come in and buy the land that was not native or was native ground was called the General Allotment Act, or the Dawes Act. I think I've heard of that, but I didn't really realize what it was. They wanted to move the railroad so that it could connect all the way to the West Coast. And that's why there's the Southern Line, which was the Pacific Northwest, Union Pacific, right? And that's the one that's a little bit more curvy because they were paying by the mile. And James J. Hill decided that no, he wanted to have it be the most direct because that's the way he would make the most money. And it was him that pushed to find the lowest pass in the Rocky Mountains, which, lo and behold, is Marias Pass. And so that is the lowest spot in the Rocky Mountains, and that's where his railroad went through. But he decided that in order to get settlers here to take advantage of the Homestead Act, he needed to do some special deals. So he started advertising. And he started advertising about the free Montana land that was available for people. I've seen some of the ads from the old newspapers, and they're huge. I mean, he really was putting on a show. You just couldn't fail. The government's giving you 320 acres. Come on out and claim it. And so not only did he do that, but if you think about it, if you had the gold rush or you had the Oregon Trail or whatever, those people all came in wagons with teams of horses or oxen or whatever. Not Haver, not the High Line. What you did here was James J. Hill would get a box car, and you could load your entire life into the box car. And so these people, and I have not been able to find that he charged them for the boxcar, but you got to put all your stuff in the boxcar. And you could even load your family in the boxcar. And the one example that I got, the lumber and nails for building a claim shanty, china dishes, tools, a wagon, a walking plow, a team of horses, a flock of ducks, 7 cows, 25 chickens, and 2 cats. There's your boxcar. But that was very common. And then what would happen is when the boxcar was obviously brought by the train and dropped off in Haver or wherever, then they used that as a staging area to go out. And at the time, Haver actually had kind of a booming cottage industry of helpers that would meet these boxcars and basically say, you know, do you have your homestead? I'll take you out and we can plot one out or pick one out. And that's how people did. And at that time, they were just starting to have cars. And so some of these land agents had cars, but most of the time it was horse and buggy and you went out and plotted your land. One of the things that I found really interesting is because, you know, nowadays, if you want to build a house or buy a plot of land, you know, you'd get it surveyed and they'd go out and tell you exactly it ends here and it ends here and whatever. And so what I'm thinking is okay, this is the middle of the prairie. How are they deciding who owns what? And where does my land end and where does yours start? And the only reference I could find that made even a little bit of sense is one guy had his wagon and he had developed a system with the wagon wheel that had something that went around and every so, I don't know how many inches, feet or whatever, it would mark the ground. And I thought, well, that's probably pretty more ingenious than most, because most people would have just walked it off. And they kind of agreed between this neighbor and that neighbor, which was your side and my side. But I don't know exactly how they did it, but they did. If you had actually lived there and done all your proving up things, then after your 3 years now, you could actually go in and prove that you had proved up your land and you got a deed for that land and then it became yours. My biggest question was, how in the world can they sell this public land that supposedly is not inhabited by anybody, but is being used by the Indian tribes? But it didn't really matter because they could do that. And so that's why the homesteads. So in this period of time from 1909, which the Homestead Act became viable here, they actually, in our area, which is the Simpson-Cottonwood area, there virtually was a homestead on every half section. It was not uncommon for there to be a man have this half section, and right next to it was his unmarried sister. And they would build shacks real close to each other in the corners so that they were neighbors. Or it would be common that 6 families would come from Minnesota and they would all line up to be neighbors. Or it was very common for there to be groups of homesteaders that were kind of connected. And between the years of 1900 and the early 1920s, there were 80,000 homesteads filed for in Montana. You think about that. The peak was in 1918, which is after World War I. And in that year, there were 14,178 homesteads filed on 3.2 million acres. This is just Montana. And the part that I found just fascinating is out of those claims, 18% were filed by single women. Okay. One of the presentations I went to, they said, oh, there's no single women that ever filed on homesteads. Or because if they were out there, they were women of ill repute or whatever. That's not true. 18% of women were single women, and you couldn't be married because then you weren't the head of the household. But that's an awful lot of homesteads. And it wasn't atypical for that single woman to have a homestead, have a shack built, either or that, or she built her shack. And lo and behold, one of her neighbors married her. And so now you had a whole section. The other thing that happened is the school teachers were often dating property. And so that was the dating pool, because the single women were either homesteaders or, yeah, okay. So the final result in Montana after 1920, there were 151,600 homesteads that were proved up, which means they stayed there long enough to get the land into their name. And that accounted for over 32 million acres, or 34% of our state was homesteaded. And I think that is absolutely amazing. I would bet that number in Hill and Blaine County was a lot higher than that. But and I don't know if you guys have noticed that you've been in Montana long enough to notice that our weather kind of goes in cycles. And so sometimes we have dry years, and sometimes we have wet years, and sometimes they're in groups. Well, what happened is 1909, when the Homestead Act came into, we were right smack dab in the middle of a beautiful wet cycle. And so these farmers came out from the Midwest, were used to having beautiful crops, good weather, good rain, good moisture. And so they just thought, 320 acres, only a fool wouldn't make it. Well, that was just fine until the 1920s, when we hit a little bit of a dry spell. A lot of the farmers that had come out for the free land all of a sudden figured out they couldn't do it. And so out of those 80,000 homesteads that had been set up, 60,000 of them did not make it. They, by the 1920s, they had packed up, gave up, or moved. And so if you think about 3 out of 4 of the original homesteads that were filed in Montana failed. So you remember at the start when I said how many were homesteaders or had relatives? You guys are the tough ones. We made it, But what I find most interesting is that not only did they make it, but the way that they made it varied a huge amount between some of the farmers. Did it solely on their land, but that was unusual. Most of the time, the farmers had to find an alternative source of income. Well, in this area, nothing was ever typical. The husband or one of the sons would go find a job in town, okay? Well, that worked for some of them, but then some of them couldn't get a job in town because there weren't that many jobs in town. So they would then hire out, and they would go over to the western part of the state and log and send the money home. Well, that was great because the money made enough that they could stay on the farm and continue to prove up their land. But it left that single lady on the homestead by herself in the middle of nowhere. Okay. What I want to point out is that this wonderful book that I'm then again trying to sell you has all these stories about the wonderful ladies and how they survived. Our grandparents on my father's side, they came from the railroad after they had gotten married, and they had their honeymoon night under a buck wagon. Halfway out to our place, which is 40 miles. But there were a lot of people that would go back east or Midwest and marry somebody and then bring them back here. And so you'd have a lady who was coming to have her that was kind of rough and ready, and they'd say, "Oh, we're gonna go out to our farm, you'll love the house." Well, it was a 10 by 12 shack that was built with no insulation and maybe a wood stove, or maybe you burn buffalo chips. Or are you guys aware of all the coal mines around Haver? That's what they did, is they dug coal. And that surprised me. I mean, I knew there had been, but these poor women, and the one, again, one of the ladies that I remember, she was brought out to her new home. And the husband says, "Well, why don't you bake bread today?" And she had been kind of a city girl, and she didn't know that anybody baked bread except the store. And so there was a couple of her neighbor ladies that came and helped her out, and she learned how to bake. But can you imagine that, just being plopped in the middle of the nowhere and, you know, here, make breakfast. So, those three out of four people that didn't make it, when they left their land, they basically didn't own it, they didn't whatever, but they probably had built their shanty shack already. But if they just left without proving it up, that then became available for another homesteader to claim. And those homesteaders did, and what it was called was a relinquishment, which means that they had given up their rights to it. And so the 1909 homesteaders that we kept track of, and quite a few of them left, well, now all of a sudden there was another name that was attached to that half section. So, but our homesteaders were the resilient ones, the tough ones. And they decided that no matter where they were at, they were a community. And the things that were important to them before they were homesteaders remained important. And so one of the first things that they did was they established a school and for their children, because most of these people had lots of kids. So they established a school, and school is a little different back then than what it is now. A lot of times it started being in somebody's back room, which when you have that small a cabin, it wasn't much of a back room, but they would hire a school teacher, and the school teacher would typically reside with one of the families in that, I don't know if you call it school district back then, but she would reside with them and live there. But the school year wasn't September to May. What happened was typically there were two sections of the school, And they went to school for about 3 months in the fall. Then they took a Christmas break because the weather and probably the snow was bad enough that they couldn't. Plus, you got to remember, these are school buildings that have no heat, except a wood stove. And so they would take a break for 2 or 3 months. And then in the spring, they would start again with another 3 or 4 months of school. And typically, the spring session and the fall session may have been taught by two different school teachers. Because lo and behold, some of those school teachers got married in between. Because like I said, they were the dating pool. And that's one thing that I'm proud of in our book, is that we not only have lists of the schools, but we also have lists of the teachers, and we also have lists of the students for just the Simpson-Cottonwood area. And it was a real learning experience. I got to go to the Hill County Superintendent of Schools and go through old record books. And all I can say is thank God I know how to read cursive, because I was cursing. Some of that writing was kind of interesting. But I, like in my particular school, I had records of my dad and all of his family going to that school, my mom and all of her family going to that school, and then coming along and here comes all of us kids. And it just shows the connection, and it shows the teachers, and brought back a lot of memories. So after I've got a school that I can send my kid to, or some of the times they sent the kids there and the kid lived there during the school week, then the next thing that was going to be important to the community was a church. And again, with the churches, a lot of them were held in individual homes. And sometimes there was an official preacher that came around, usually from town. But a lot of times it was just a lay minister that was teaching. But even with, well, maybe I should backtrack a little. I'm referring to the Simpson-Cottonwood area. And if you don't know, if you go directly north of Haver, like you're headed towards Canada, about 2 miles out, the road splits and goes to St. Joe and Wild Horse. Okay, if you go on the Wild Horse, it's probably about 45 miles to the border, and about halfway there is Cottonwood. And Cottonwood was the main hub to start with. And that was because there was a coal mine there. There was good access to the Milk River for water. And then if you go further on that, another 20 miles, you'd come to Simpson. And Simpson is about 5 miles from the Canadian border. And in that individual area for churches, well, for schools, there was 7 different schools established just in that area. For churches, there was 4 different churches. And the schools, what is really interesting is to find out is the schools were portable. What do I mean by that? Well, this one particular example, the new border school was right here. And it was because it was halfway between Hendrickson's that had 10 kids and Greytack's that had 8. Hendrickson's either failed, left, or whatever. And all of a sudden, the school, which had been halfway located between the two, now was way far away from the people that were on the other side. And so they ended up moving the school down closer to Central. And that's what they had to do when there was kids, and the kids were walking. because there was no other way, or riding their horses. As a matter of fact, one of the schools that was, by Hendrickson's house that did not get moved, got sold because they didn't need it anymore because there weren't enough kids. And it was owned by Floyd Whaley, because he bought it and moved it down and used it as a shop for years and years. Okay, so now we got the school and we got the church. Now we need to have mail. So we need to set up a post office. We need to have stores. So they did. They set up stores. I don't think they were quite as elaborate as Buttry's, but they had places where people could stop and pick up supplies. And Cottonwood was one of those. Connolly's ran that. And then there also was one at Miller. Do you guys know there was a town named Miller? There were seven Miller families that came out together. I'm presuming they had more than one boxcar. And they formed a town called Miller. And there was a Miller school, there's a Miller cemetery, they had a store, they had a post office. All gone. Then as part of the community development, they had to have some fun things to do. And so pretty soon there becomes community halls. We were talking about Cottonwood Hall, and St. Joe had a community center. But it was not uncommon for the homesteaders to get together for celebrations, or church or whatever. And depending on the time of the year, you might go to a party. Everybody would have brought something. Potluck, that's where we all learned how to make potlucks. But the problem was there was no light. And so a lot of times if there was a party and it wasn't a full moon, people just stayed. And then when it became light in the morning, then they would go home. But it was not uncommon for them to have softball games, dances. Music was very, very important. And if somebody showed up and they played the accordion, or they didn't really have pianos back then, but accordions, violins, anything that was portable, and they played, and they basically played all night. Oh, okay, now that we've partied, we also have to have cemeteries. So they also marked off areas for cemeteries. There were a few places where small family cemeteries were developed, but most of the time they were community cemeteries. And so in the Simpson-Cottonwood area, there's the Spring Cooley Cemetery. There is the Miller Cemetery, which as far as I know only has seven Millers buried there. There's the Catholic Cemetery, and then there's a smaller Lutheran Cemetery. So now I've developed most of my community. Only one thing is missing. Did you know that there are some bad people out there? So because we're at least 20 or 40 miles away from town, we better develop our own law enforcement system. Which brings me to another wonderful section in the book that I'm trying to sell you. Simpson chapter of the Anti-Horse Thief Association. Has anybody ever heard of it? Okay, In the Midwest, Missouri, Illinois, whatever, anti-horse thief associations were quite common. They were kind of a local law enforcement thing. Well, because a lot of the people who moved to the Simpson area came from the Midwest, they were used to that. And so they developed the Simpson chapter of the Anti-Horse Thief Association. My sister Arlene, we're fortunate enough that on my father's side, he must have been one of the people that formed that association, because we have all of the records and we have the minutes of the Anti-Horse Thief Association, and all of that is included in the book. Arlene found a seal that says AHTA. And what I find interesting is that not everybody could belong. And so there was some people, and they would have meetings and would determine whether so-and-so was allowed into the association. And some of the descriptions on why people were not allowed into the association were kind of funny, because it was sketchy, dishonest. No. Yeah. But it absolutely is fascinating, please read it. The other thing that was kind of unique was, again, most of the homesteaders out there were single men, but there were a lot of families. Well, guess what? The single men didn't want to stay single. And so the other thing that was formed out there was the Simpson Bachelors Club. Mm-hmm. Pretty self-explanatory. They had a club of single men that met on a regular basis. They had dues, and they used those dues to make a gathering spot, dance hall, whatever, and then sponsored events, including dances. And so they would sponsor a dance, and they would say, ask the ladies to make cakes. And so that's how they did it. And the one that stands out to me, there was a couple of, they were talking, I can't remember the guy's name, but they said, David Jones has not been here now for 3 months, and he's $15 behind on his dues. Okay, well, that's probably a big deal. Except the very next month, it comes back and it says, David Jones is here and he's been missing meetings because he got married.
I just encourage you all. We've been blessed that my grandparents, my grandmother saved all these records. And so for me to be able to go in and find all these minute books and record books and be able to reconstruct these stories, because my grandpa died and left my grandmother this scrawny, tall lady. I obviously took over after the other side of the family, but left her alone with six kids north of Haver, and she was able to do the farm and do everything. But we've got all these record books and all the minute books of the Anti-Horse Thief Association. And I have researched that fraternal organization a lot, and it is fascinating. And then we have all the stuff from the Simpson Bachelors Club. So old pictures, old minutes of things that you guys think, oh, well, nobody will be interested in that. Oh, man, there's somebody always interested. And we were able to recreate some of these stories because we had all that information. And I just can't tell you, there's just some really fun stuff to read in the book that it just makes you realize what a fun thing it was.
You wanna talk about the initiation ceremonies?
Oh. So in the attic of the farmhouse, I always knew that there was this long box thing, and there was this chair there too, and it had a gauge on it with two levers on it, and part of the initiation thing was you're supposed to pull up on these levers as hard as you could to see how strong you were. Well, as you pulled, it released a lever that came up and slapped the guy right in the rear with a big thing and a chair that then fell apart and things. So there was a part of the initiation thing too. But you can tell that it was just neighbors looking after neighbors, but also they looked after horse thieves. I mean, they definitely were watching stock and livestock, and there was people that they turned over to, you know, to the sheriff's department for prosecution. And but when you're 40 miles north of Havre, you have to have some kind of a semblance of law and order. So it just fascinating stories that we have, and we were able to recreate it and put it in the book as much as we could. So Dawn Graytack's mother, Gladys Graytack, lived with my grandparents when she was a single little school teacher, and of course Al Graytack met her, and the rest is history. So that's a good thing that that happened too, and they were wonderful, wonderful neighbors. So
now I'm coming back to shill the book. The book, in the even more years gone by, is it Doug Mitchell?
Yep.
Brought one of the old books. Sorry, there you are. The original book was called In the Years Gone By, and it was developed by, it was written by the Cottonwood Home Demonstration Club ladies. And at that time, it was done originally in 1964, and it was done in honor of the 75th anniversary of Montana statehood. And at that time, when they did it in 1964, there were still a lot of the original homestead families that were there. And so the Cottonwood Home Demonstration ladies either had their family members write up their history, or in the case of people who I can't write, or I, you know, whatever, then my sister would go with my mom, and my mom would go and get their stories and would type them up. Well, this is 1964, so there's no such thing as a word processor. There's no such thing as a computer, which meant that they typed on a manual typewriter and corrected themselves. Well, to make matters more interesting, there were enough stories that they had to have more than one typist. And so the two typists who got to do it all were my mother, Ruth Morse, and her sister, Mary Melland. Now, why did those two get selected? Because they had the exact same Smith Corona typewriter, and that font matched. But that's how they did the original book. Well, in 1964, that book sold out, and there's only of a few of us old timers or lucky guys who have been able to find one. So 25 years after the original, in 1989, they decided to reprint the book. And so they reprinted the book. And that book, too, is virtually impossible to find. But it basically was just a reprint. It was the exact same book, just a different binding and format. And so I either blame or credit Isla Whaley McClanahan for saying, I really think this should be updated. I really think we should update this history book and bring us all up to date. And then she roped us in. And she got me and Arlene, Isla, Sandy Patera Spinner, Pete Velk,
Leroy Keller.
Leroy Keller, Don Greytak, and Julie Verplugen. Anyway, we all took a little piece of this and put it together. The book cover, you may have noticed, is definitely not my artwork. This is an original that was done by Donnie Greytak, who was on our committee. And that is a hand-drawn picture of the Simpsons store, Mrs. Fitch's store, including the gas pump. And if you're a fan of Donnie's work, you probably will have seen that gas pump in other pictures.
I called him this morning, Elaine, and said you were going to be here and he should come down, but I never heard back.
Yeah, he's not much of a...
I know.
No.
Not a social butterfly.
Well, and the other thing is we might brag about him, and he's pretty humble. But he, that was his contribution to the book. And we actually have the original drawing of this that we display down at the museum. But this new book that I would love to sell you, how am I doing? Contains everything that was in that first book from 1964, including the stories and the pictures. But then what was done is that we have gone in and updated each family's stories to bring them up to date to where, you know, now they have 27 grandchildren and the homestead is farmed by so-and-so and, you know, and some of the stories are a little more detailed than others. It's kind of like going to a potluck. And you have somebody that'll talk your ear off and tell you stories that you're pretty sure are not true. And then you have the matter-of-fact, cut-and-dried lady who's, yep, that was in June of 67. And so there's all sorts of stories in here. In addition to updating those people stories, and I actually went through and counted them, and there are 109 different family stories in the original book that have now been updated. But there's other things, other articles that are appropriate for the homestead era, including Homesteading Act, which included a lot of the information I gave you today, bootlegging and prohibition, and that's a whole nother hour of talking. And it also was some of the things that were done instead of going logging. There was some entrepreneurial bootlegging going on. The Simpson Bachelor Club, there's a whole article about it. The Simpson Anti-Horse Thief Association. There's, like I said, lists of students. And then there's also lists that show the original school maps, and also the original homesteader sections. Oh, and then there's also a wonderful article about Long George Francis. That's about all I had, and I would be happy to answer questions if anybody is still awake.
How did you fit all the colors in there?
She named it Living.
Pardon me? How did you fit all the colors in there?
That one was really pretty easy, because Leroy Keller was on our board, and we said, Leroy, take care of it, and he did. And then after we turned it in and put the book up, then his youngest sister came and said, oh, he made a lot of mistakes, but don't worry, I fixed it. So.
What about the medical field? Did they have doctors? And so what did they do?
The couple of stories that I saw where they referred to somebody getting in an accident or being sick, they basically said it was so far to the doctor or so far to send for medical help that you either got better or you died. And that was kind of there was one where there was a house fire that they actually took somebody to town. But most of the time it was first aid, I'm guessing. But the stories are fascinating. If you know the people, it is really interesting. And if you don't know the people, it is still interesting because you think, my God, how in the world did they survive from day to day?
Yeah, you know, my grandfather died really, really young out there. 43, and left my grandmother with six kids and a wonderful whopping $83, two cows, two horses, and
that was in the will.
Yeah, the estate that got settled. And she didn't drive. And I think about that tough stock that we came from 160 acres. And I am proud to say, you know, the Morse families have farmed lots of acres out north of Havre, and we have this wonderful, proud heritage that we came from tough, tough stock. And my grandma, she lived till the 90s. And she didn't want to be in the hospital. She got sick and got in the hospital. And she got the nurse in the bathroom and put the chair, kicked it underneath the doorknob, and walked home. And so, you know, those are the things that you just know that they had a tough, tough life. And but what a wonderful way to grow up. And what wonderful stories that we have. And I don't care if you think that your story isn't important, and maybe your son or your daughter isn't interested. There's going to be a granddaughter or a grandson or a niece or nephew that's interested in that someday, and write it down. So I am so blessed. I had my mom tell, she was 91 years old, and she wrote stories down. And how wonderful. Write your stories down and tell your stories to people, because we come from a proud heritage. It's what makes us tough Montanans, and I appreciate that. So, yeah. I hope you guys enjoy the book. So.
And there's some stories that I don't believe were completely told, and others that were, and it kind of depends. There's a shooting death that happened because two young renegades decided that they were going to go raiding, and what they got caught. And that's the one name in the cemetery that I was having trouble figuring out. I got it now, because he got shot and killed.
What's his name?
Benedict.
Arnold.
Yeah, no, it's Mrs. Fitch's son by her first husband. Is anybody interested in genealogy? Okay, have you guys found the site called Find a Grave? If you haven't, you need to, because it's just a gold mine of information. And so some of these families that I had trouble finding information on, that was the only way I could track.
You got a question way back there.
Well, you were talking about the Bachelor's Club. Did they possibly order male, order brides?
You know, I couldn't find records of that in the minutes at all, but their whole goal was to get some single ladies out there so they would have some entertainment, because it was just a bunch of bachelors out there, and so they wanted to have events out there, and then just a camaraderie to try to get there. I'm sure the school teachers didn't have any shortage of male suitors, but
well, I read somewhere that, I don't know if this is fiction, but a lot of the school teachers were young people, but if they got married, then they couldn't teach anymore.
Right.
Right. Right. Yeah, so I wrote an article about the Bachelor's Club in there, and then one of the guys that did a lot of the building of the school, and he was a school teacher and everything, and we farmed his land and had a lot of the record books, and it's just a fun story to read. It was in the Havre Daily News too. If you go in the archives, it would be listed in that as well too. So, yeah. And this book is also in the library too.
Yeah, the Havre Public Library actually came and has bought, I think, 4 copies of this. So if you don't wish to buy it, you can check it out there.
I do have a question to piggyback off the last one. Why were the women no longer allowed to teach after they married? Maybe there's a really practical, obvious.
It was just that was the custom. Yeah.
Was it just teachers?
Oh. Yeah.
Any woman who was.
They probably started raising families, is what I would guess, you know. Okay. So, yeah.
Yeah, but once they were married, they were done.
Okay. Back into the domestic sphere they went.
Yeah.
Okay. Right. All right. Thank you.
Yeah.
She's very young.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't think there was any rules, so. Yeah.
Yeah,
and there was quite a few male. There was quite a few male teachers too.
Okay.
Yeah.
I got a question, Bill. On land when they bought that in the late 1800s, did they have to pay like $1.50 an acre for homestead land, or was that you just paid it as you went? There's a rumor on it. I don't know.
The railroad was able to buy the land for $1.25 an acre. And then sell it or build on it or whatever. And that's how some of the public land got turned over to homesteaders. Yeah, but $1.25. I think I might buy a section.
When did they get telephone out there?
Oh, that was after we were there. So 50s?
Party line.
We had party lines, and I know our party line, we had 8 families on it. I know it was probably the 50s. I also remember the first time we got a television.
We got our party line in 1957. We had 6 people on it.
There you go. Some of the electrification kind of went in groups. It's sort of like the paving of the road. You went so far and then you're on your own.
Having a one-room schoolhouse to go to was just the best in the world. And rode my motorcycle, rode my horse, drove a car. The teachers hated that because we all drove to school. But in 4th grade, I was with one of the Cox boys, too, in school. And whoever got the highest grade on the spelling test got to take the teacher's car down to Kate's store at Simpson and get candy bars and pop and bring them back. And that was in 4th grade because we were all driving to school anyway. So things have kind of changed over the years.
You mentioned that the dances would go till the sun came up the next morning because there weren't lights on the carriages and the
automobiles
that might have been there. But I think that must have been so much fun because I remember in the mid-50s that we never left Cottonwood to go home till the daylight. Yeah.
No, and the trunks were always open. I couldn't figure that one out.
Yeah. Well, there was always a midnight supper. That's when the midnight was that midnight. And you kept dancing, so
always
absolutely.
And if you put your baby in the cloakroom, don't forget him.
Yep. I never got any taller because I slept the entire time in the back window of the car all the time. That's where I slept.
Are there any other questions, or would anybody else like to share memories?
Tom, you
take a couple minutes.
Oh, sure. Tom's got some stories.
I'm not going to get near that. You can all hear me without that. I'm Tom Keller, and I can answer for you how you replaced women. You got them in this minute. So the story starts that, any of you born on the wrong side of the track? Or felt you were? Well, we were born on the wrong side of the river. My mother's family came from a little community called Goldstone. It was just across the Milk River from Simpson. And so my mother was one of six children, and she was a female. Sorry, but this is the way it was. And when you get to the eighth grade, if you made it that far, you were kind of excess baggage and you needed to go do something with your life. So my mother's sister was Katie Whaley. Katie married Floyd Whaley, and they were the people that actually lived at the town of Simpson. So Katie, when she got out of the eighth grade, didn't swim the river, but she went across and went to work at this store for Mrs. Fish. And she worked for Mrs. Fish for a number of years until she met Floyd and they married.
Mrs. Fish's store.
Yeah.
They established a farm that was next door neighbors to these wonderful Morrises. So you have to have the store, and you had to have the post office, and you had to man that. And that was frequently done by women. It's not a man's world in these days, it's a woman's world. So how do you get a wife for Floyd Whaley? Go to the store. Would seem like a simple thing, but that's kind of how it happened. In the generations that came after that, what do you do with your children, and how do they find partners, and how does that propagate? And all this land that was relinquished, whatever happened to that? You had too many kids, they needed to get started, you helped your children get started, whether that was your daughter in another generation of your farm, or whether you kind of guided your daughter to the place next door where there was a guy. It wasn't as hard to propagate this thing once you had people there. The trick was just to get them there and to keep them after they started. My grandparents that ended up over at Goldstone ended up on a relinquishment that some people ahead of them had tried to homestead games, long gone. A brother that was in Hingham heard there was land open clear up at Goldstone, and you go and get it, and that's the way it works. Sometimes there were people that were already there. And when you started about how do you know which piece of land is yours, believe it or not, this whole gig was supposed to have been surveyed before it was ever open to homesteading. The key word there was supposed to be. When the surveyors came around to do this, what do you do with the people that are already there? There was a great number of people. Not just a few, there were a great number of people in the United States west of the Mississippi River when we decided to do this homestead gig. And as the surveyors came along, they had to leave the people as conveniently as they could on the land they were already living. So what happens if this guy has his little claim and it's in three different quarter sections? You carved him out and you did that. Has anybody ever been on a site called BLMGLO? If you do that, you can see pictures of homesteads. You can see where they lay. And they're the doggonest conglomeration of things you've ever seen. And you'll see some that don't make any sense. You've got this little piece over here, this here. They just barely even touch. Somebody squatted in the middle of that. And that's why these homestead claims had to go around it. What's interesting is who was there and what the heck were they doing? In our area, is anybody familiar with a farm that was farmed by a family named Augustin that's up on the Milk River? Yeah. If you go there, and if you go across the crossing, trying to get from Simpson to Goldstone or back, you'll meet a dugout that's cut into the side of the hill, and there's this big rock lintel that's probably 8 feet wide across there. That's dated 1867. A little early for the 1909 troops to show up, isn't it? Those folks were there about four generations before anybody even thought of coming to homestead. Now what do you do with them? Well, of course, they take this piece and they just have a river in their backyard, so they take that piece. And how do you make homesteaders go around that? It was rather interesting because how do you breach this river and get people to go to the other side of it? Not everybody had a boxcar to go up a river. What do you do when you get to the dumb thing, and where do you go with it? A lot of the people that got transported went across bridges, and you mentioned Dawn and the bootlegging and one of the most interesting things. I was trying to find more information on the famous story where he just burned the bridge behind him. And Don's a great guy. We went out and he said, well, here's the foundations of the bridge. And of course, I said, all right, now I need to remember how to get there. He said, oh, just go out to Pigeon Store and turn south and you'll get real close. It gets more interesting as you go along and start putting flesh on the bone and what happened. Who were these people that did it and what happened to them? In the case of my aunt, Katie, who happens to be my godmother, I'm a little prejudiced. When Mrs. Fitch retired and got out of the business, Katie and Floyd just moved the store up to the town of Simpson. And Kate became the postmistress, and it just stayed there well into the, I believe, end of the 80s, if I remember correctly. Yeah. And so communities kind of propagated, and the next generation of children, and the marriages came along. But it wasn't as hard to find the dear ladies to start these as one might think. But they didn't all have their own idea of coming along. Some of the greatest stories of that part of the country were of independent ladies who claimed their homesteads and actually proved them and weren't necessarily looking for a guy to do that. I can take care of this myself. And I think those are some of the better stories. I won't go on any longer, but we could probably go into the burial and the non-cemetery that we were at.
But
I don't think we've got enough time for that.
Okay.
Anyhow, any questions on that stuff that I can give you answers to?
Was that Mark and Carrie Ark, Augustine?
No. Actually, Mark and Carrie are across the road at a little community that was called... Thank you, sis. My sister's got a brain and I don't anymore. Our grandparents were named Joe and Teresa Fisher, and one of the things that has trickled down to me is my grandfather's Social Security card, which was sent to him, Joseph Fisher, Fairchild, Montana. And there was a small post office there. Fairchild was just east of Goldstone. And Mark and Terry Augustin have now built a place right on the site of Fairchild. And they're still there. The next family of Augustins was north of there that went back down to the river. The next family of them went back west. And like everybody else, they had their hard times, and they lost a piece of land. They lost it to the bank. My grandfather, an Ukrainian immigrant who didn't read or write, and didn't do a real good job of farming either. My grandma didn't farm it. Tell you the truth. Come on, women are the heroes. Had the wherewithal to buy that piece of ground when it came up for sale, and it was always a sticking point because he owned a piece of that August place. And when my uncle finally broke up the farm and sold it many, many years later, the first people that got their chunk back was the August family. So it's a really great story. And yet, those people, we're about two generations removed and a little more than that. Yeah. And the families are very, very close to this day, you know, and there's any animosity about that.
Well,
anyhow, thank you for letting me start
off. Are you ready for me to shut up?
Nice job.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And as Arlene said, if you have stories, write them down while you still kind of remember them, because that's what we said when we started writing the book. If we don't do it, who will? And trust me, even write down the shady stories, because those are the most fun. Thank you.
Thank you again, Elaine. Let's have another hand for Elaine. Thank you. And thank you as well, Arlene, for standing up and speaking. And everybody's great questions and stories as well. Please also help me thank Ginger for her time, for preparing all this wonderful food. And as always, for willingness to host these events at the Shields Senior Center. Finally, thank you all so much for coming out. And thank you, Blake Downs, as well. He's our videographer for recording this. And we'll have that recording available online here within the next couple of months. So look forward to that. Thank you all for being here. Have a good evening.